Welcome back to Written for Life, a podcast to help you learn how to study your Bible. I'm the host, Chris Page. I'm a student pastor in Virginia, and really enjoyed working on this podcast these last few weeks. The last few episodes, we had some guests that talked about their Bible study when they were teenagers. A couple of them are currently teenagers, and they talked about how they got started studying the Bible in middle and high school. And so I encourage you to go listen to those interviews and hear from those guys about some of the things they shared. It was really helpful and enlightening, and it was cool to see they referenced a lot of things that we had talked about already, but also added some new things. But I thought it was a great encouragement to hear, you know, here's some people who started studying the Bible in middle school or high school on their own, and for them to share that. But today I want to talk about a tool that's going to actually lead to a series of several tools I want to give you as you continue your journey of learning to study the Bible. There's a method of Bible study out there. It's been around for a very long time. There's whole study Bibles written around this method. It's called the inductive Bible study method. And I never really used this growing up specifically. I didn't use this specific guide with the terminology we're going to talk about. But when it comes down to it, most versions of good Bible study involve pretty much the same thing. I like the terms that this uses, and I think it helps bring some clarity. And there's a lot of tools out there with it because it's been around so long. And like I said, there's even study Bibles that are, the inductive study Bible. They're written to guide you through this process. And so it's three steps. It's called observe, interpret, and apply. And that we're going to walk through each one of those in separate episodes. So today I'm just going to talk about observing, which is simply, looking at the passage and asking yourself, what does it say? You're just making observations about what you see in front of you. And so there's nine things here. I've actually got a inductive Bible study method guide pulled up here on the web, and I'm just going to read you some of their suggestions and make a few comments very quickly. Number one, as we've talked about in the very first episode, begin with prayer. A lot of times that's the missing element in Bible study. Just ask the Lord and His Spirit to show you and teach you from what you're about to read. Step number two, ask the five W's and an H, meaning the who, what, when, where, how, and why questions. Just read it and make observation. What's going on here? Who's involved? And what's happening? Number three, mark key words and phrases. We talked about this a few episodes ago, the importance of words. That the Bible uses specific words on purpose. And so paying attention to words you do know, paying attention to words you're not familiar with, marking those for reference, especially repeated words. Number four, make lists. There's a lot of passages in the Bible that, are a series of lists, whether it's the fruit of the Spirit or the qualifications of an elder or, the locations that we should be going to in the Great Commission. All these things involve lists. And so sometimes listing those out and kind of taking those one at a time, what are these things that are being listed and why do they matter? Number five, watch for contrasts and comparisons. Contrasts and comparisons use highly descriptive language to make it easier to remember what you've learned. And so these are good things to look for. This happens a lot in the Proverbs and the Psalms, but also in passages like 1 Peter, where he compares the devil to a lion. And so that's another way that you can think about comparisons. Number six, note expressions of time. So thinking about, does it say it's midday? Does it say it's a certain hour? Does it say it's at night? That can help give you a picture of what you're doing. Number seven, geographical locations. Where are they? Sometimes it'll say they're in a town or a city or a country, or they'll say they're in a specific building or they're on a mountain. And so that can help. Number eight, pay attention to words of conclusion, meaning things like therefore or thus or for this reason. That can help you indicate that what this verse is telling me is wrapping up something that's come before it, right? And then number nine, identify chapter themes. Themes are often revealed by reviewing the key words and lists you develop. Now, obviously, this is some stuff you'll learn as you give it a try. But here's what I wanted to do really quick is, again, just give you a couple of examples of using this, looking at two different Bible passages. So the first one we're going to look at is Mark chapter 3. This is the story where Jesus goes into the synagogue. I'll read it here in a second, and he heals somebody. But it's important to remember, we talked about this earlier, of knowing what kind of section of the Bible you're reading. Is this a letter? Is this a poem? Is it a story? or narrative. And if you're not sure what it is, you could ask somebody or you could look it up online, or if you have a study Bible, it'll tell you. But the book of Mark is a biography of Jesus. It's a narrative. It's telling a story. And so stories are going to be really easy to use those five W's and an H observation thing. Who, what, where, when, why, how. Because there's a story unfolding. So let me read it, and then we'll kind of just do this with that. Mark chapter 3, verse 1. Again he entered the synagogue, and a man was there with a withered hand. And they watched Jesus to see whether he would heal him on the Sabbath, so that they might accuse him. And he said to the man with the withered hand, "Come here." And he said to them, "Is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do harm, to save life or to kill?" And they were silent. And he looked around at them with anger, grieved at their hardness of heart, and said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored. The Pharisees went out and immediately held counsel with the Herodians against him, how to destroy him. Okay, so very simple, quick story. Jesus goes to this place. He heals this guy. Some people get mad. And so if you're reading this for the first time, you're probably going to already pick up, okay, Jesus healed somebody. But some people got mad. That's weird. I wonder why. And so you can, and you know, the Sabbath, what is that? And so here's how you can start applying these observation things, right? You ask the five W's, like who's in the passage? You know, and again, this passage starts off, it just says he entered the synagogue. So you go, oh, well, who's he? So you might have to go back a verse to the last chapter. Oh, it's Jesus, right? Who else? There's a man with a withered hand. Okay, so there's that guy. So there's Jesus. There's this man with some sort of problem with his body, medical problem. And then it says, and they watched Jesus. Now, later on, we figure out it's the Pharisees, but so far, they are watching. And so let's see who else. So that seems to be the main characters. We go through the passage. There's Jesus, the Pharisees, and this sick guy. Right? So that's our who. What? Or let's go to where. He entered the synagogue. Okay, if you're not familiar with what a synagogue is, you might have to look that word up. Okay, what's a synagogue? Where is he at? And you realize it's like the Jewish, kind of like going to Jewish church. So he's in the place where they gather to read the Bible and talk about God. So he's in a spiritual place. All right, and then when, it says after he entered the synagogue, there was a man with a withered hand, so he's here. And then, so that's when, but it says on the Sabbath. Now again, if you're not familiar with like, what's the Sabbath? Again, you could look that up. And for the Jewish people, the Sabbath was the seventh day of the week, and it was supposed to be a day of rest. And if you're looking that up, you'll learn that. Okay, they're supposed to not do any work. And so that also on their days of the week, that would be the seventh day. So for us, it would be like Saturday. So then you could kind of go back and, you know, kind of give yourself, okay, it's like he went into church on a Saturday, and they're not supposed to do any work. And so these gay people are watching him to wonder if he'll heal because they consider that working, maybe. And so, again, all of that is, the whole point here is not just we're going to fully study this. It's just to help you begin to see this is how this helps you begin to dig a little deeper and notice more things, you know. You notice phrases like heal him on the Sabbath so that they can accuse him. What would they accuse him of? Then again, why would they do that? So it makes you ask the easy questions lead you to deeper questions, which kind of sends you on a journey of, well, why is that? And then you look it up and you begin to discover, oh, I get it. And of course, I'm kind of jumping ahead, but you'll figure out the Pharisees were very strict about the laws and you're not supposed to do any work and healing is like doing a work. So if Jesus heals this guy, then he's breaking God's law and that's, you know, we don't like that. And so that's why it ends with them really mad about it. And so that can help you, again, get more out of it than just the initial first reading. All right? So let's go to another one. So I want to do a different type of passage, but here's a verse that many of you know or probably have heard, or you've seen athletes wear it or whatever. Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. All right, so let's try the same thing here. Now, again, we've talked about what are we reading? We're not reading narrative. We're not reading a story. We're reading a letter. Paul is writing this letter to a group of Christians. And so you can, you know, sometimes it goes without saying, but you have to just stop and realize if somebody wrote you a letter or an email or a text message, a really long one or something, you wouldn't just pick one line right out of the middle and read it and then stop, right? That you need context for this one line that's in this letter or this email. You need to see everything else that's written. And so that's why it's important, especially in these letters, is not to take a single verse and just, I know that verse. You know, because what is he talking about? I can do all things. What things? Why did he even get to talking about needing strength? Strength for what? What things? You know, so these questions can, again, you're asking the who, what, where, when. Based on this verse, we don't really know when. We don't really know where. But he does say what. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. That's what's going on. That must be the writer talking. So you do a little bit of research. Oh, it's the Apostle Paul. It's the Apostle Paul's writing. He can do all things through him. Early in the verses, he talks about Jesus. So it must be Jesus who gives me strength. But as you begin to realize, okay, this is Paul talking about having strength through Christ to do all things. Again, you go back to, this is a letter. There must be more to this. So you need the context. You need to read the verses around it to see what led him to make this statement, right? And again, I think that's important because there's so many verses like this that we hear the verse by itself and we think it means one thing. But if you go back and read the whole letter, you realize it means something very different. And so these are just two ways to start. Again, I'm jumping ahead a little bit, but the point is just to observe. Take time just to see what's there before you even get around to worrying about what does this mean or what do I do with this. This is just the step that's just trying to figure out what is this passage saying? Who's involved? What's going on? Because that, once you establish that, that can lead you to interpret it the right way and know, okay, this is what's happening and this is who's there and this is what's going on. So this is why they said this, and that's what it means. And so we'll get to the interpreting step next. But hopefully this observation step helped you. I encourage you this week in your Bible study, just pick some verses or pick a chapter. Figure out where you're at. Is it a letter, narrative, poem, whatever it is? And then just start asking questions. Make lists. Look at words. Ask who, what, where, when, how, why. Think about where they are. And just kind of start making observations about what you're seeing. But I hope this helps, and look forward to seeing you next time on Written for Life.